very pleased to introduce my friend Skylar Cowan, who is a locker room extraordinaire, and also really more than anything else, an ambassador for the entire sport of lockpicking. So that's pretty much all you can say.
Excellent. Thank you very much. I am equally pleased to to be able to come here today and talk. One big caveat for this talk is that I'm getting over a nasty cold, so if I'm hacking and wheezing my way through this, try not to be too grossed out. There'll be good lock information tucked in amongst the nose blowing, I promise. So, this is the lock talk at Olin. I've become, I've lost all imagination when it comes to titling my talks, so now every talk I give is just the lock talk at wherever I happen to be at. Who am I? I am Skylar Town. I'm a professional lock picker. I was trying to figure out what to put down on the census form for Cambridge the other day, and agonized for probably a solid like 20-25 minutes just trying to figure out what to write down for that. I eventually wrote down researcher, because I do a lot of research. I founded NDE Magazine, that's Non-Destructive Entry Magazine. It's been dormant for I think like 3 years now. But we put out some good stuff when we published, and we're finally getting content together to relaunch it in probably spring, summer 2011. And Open Lock Sport, woo! Recently got t-shirts, so I'm very excited about them. Open Lock Sport is a, I designed and launched my own line of lock picks. Did the funding via Kickstarter.com. Kickstarter is a phenomenal crowdfunding service where you say, hey, I have this big idea. If you give me this small portion of the funds I need to get it started, I will give you something in return. So I basically did a pre-sale of my tools and said, if you give X amount, you get this many picks, Y amount, etc. And then bigger, crazier things like if you give me thousands of dollars, I'll fly to you and train you, etc. So I was trying to raise $6,000 and I ended up raising $87,000. So it turns out there's an interest. And as a result of that is how I got to be this. Because up until that money coming through, I was a graphic designer. Okay. I'm also really easy to track down. Skylartown.com and hey. And it's my easiest form of communication is actually Twitter. I'm at Shoebox on there. I am a former Wheel of Fortune contestant. I forgot I put that in there. And I'm obsessed with locks. So I recently bought myself a mini mill, and it's in my bedroom, but this is me on the mini mill cutting into some locks. I'm going to cut the lights down a little bit because we're going to go over the first portion of the talk.
The bottom, or the
second to bottom? Yeah. The first portion of the talk is going to be just about some of the beautiful mechanical ideas and some of my favorite locks. So there's going to be a lot of photos, and we're going to go a little bit darker with the lights, and then we're going to transition into some patent diving and then to some history. So here I am rocking the mini mill. A couple of pieces of advice if you ever put a mini mill in your bedroom. One, don't put it right next to your home office because there are going to be brass shavings everywhere. And two, understand that this device will keep you out of a relationship. okay. So, I love locks. I think they're absolutely beautiful, just remarkable little mechanical. People say puzzles, but it's I don't know, they're a little more, a little beyond that. All sorts. These are all just things that I've cut on the mill. This is an Avis Plus disc detainer lock. Beautiful, safe dial combination cutaway. So I'm not going to go deep into how simple locks work and how basics of lock picking work, but there are a couple of concepts that you're going to need to be familiar with. I'll hit those as we describe the function of various higher security and curiosity locks. So this was the Medico. The important part about the Medico is that it actually has two locking mechanisms. The primary locking mechanism is your basic pin tumbler. It has key pins with driver pins over them. Your key lifts them up to the right heights and the whole system can turn freely. That's how normal locks work. Basic idea. However, these pins also rotate. And when they rotate, they allow a sidebar in the side portion of the lock to drop into place. It's a very clever and very simple modification of your basic pin tumbler lock. It's taking a pin tumbler lock and pushing it just a little step further. So what you can see better in the photo I'm about to show are the angled cuts of the key. Instead of having normal, flat, straight across cuts, they're cut to various angles. The pins have chisel tips on them, so that as the key inserts itself in the lock, the chisel tip will orient itself to face the various angles. The slot that's cut out of the side of the pin will marry into the teeth of the sidebar. So, without the correct key inserted up here at the top, you see that the gates on the pins aren't lined up correctly and that they're at incorrect heights. Down here on the bottom, with everything lined up nicely, each of the gates is lined up facing the sidebar so the teeth of the sidebar can drop into place and they're all at the appropriate heights. Now, when attacking this lock, you'd think that you have to both lift and rotate the pins in order to attack it. However, when we pick locks, and this is one of those basic concepts that you'll need to know as we move forward in the talk, what we're doing is taking advantage of small mechanical tolerances, the slight differences between each part of the lock. Every pin won't be perfectly deburred. Every hole, every pin chamber won't be drilled in a perfect line, etc., etc. So that by taking advantage of those small differences, we're able to pick our way through the lock and open it. With the Medico, because of those tolerances, you can either lift all of the pins or rotate them. And once you've set either the primary locking mechanism, just of the heights, or the secondary locking mechanism of the sidebar, then you move on to the next. So you can break the attack into discrete parts. That's the very important thing. So this is a high security lock, difficult to pick. But when you break it into those discrete parts and you attack one mechanism first and then the other, you can absolutely open them. However, there was a much cooler lock. And the story of this lock is a little bit tragic, but it had a similar lift and rotate mechanism. This is the M-heart interlocking. Once again, there are angles cut into the key instead of just cut flat across. But these are the pins. This is your driver pin, this is your key pin, and they're actually interlocked into one another. So with the wrong key in the lock, they won't be rotated to the right position to be able to slide along, and they won't be at the proper heights in order to separate. And with the proper key in, they'll all be lined up correctly and can slide along the groove cut into the plug. Now, this lock takes the problem with the Medico, the fact that we can compartmentalize the attack and open the Medico by attacking one mechanism and the other, and makes it so that for every pin we're attacking this lock, we have to both lift and rotate to exactly the right position as we attack it. This makes them incredibly difficult to pick. However, Medico sued them out of business. what happened is that there was a settlement, and M-heart was taken over by Medico, their lock division. M-heart is still a large manufacturing company, but haven't produced locks for many years. So M-heart was taken over by Medico, but instead of taking this technology and adopting it into their product line, they simply allowed it to die, which is a bummer. And the M-heart is one of my... The only real reason that I talked about the Medico was so that we could talk about the M-heart, and how much I love the M-heart, how it's one of my... like top three locks in the list of locks that I desperately want to own. The M-heart, thankfully, I own several of. It was an American lock, so despite them no longer being manufactured, you can still get your hands on them here or there. I have a bunch of cutaways, a bunch of individual cylinders. I love it to death. The next company we're going to discuss is Fichet. And I've owned several of these locks. Most of these photos are actually out of my own collection, but the last two will not be. So I guess that's 50-50. This is the Fichet 450. These keys are shaped like I-beams, and each side of those keys operates an individual set of levers inside of this lock. Now, really, all I want to focus on with the Fichets is their gorgeous keys. So, every time I pull out a fichet key, people are like, whoa, that's ridiculous. And it is. Sorry. I should really just turn the touchpad off for this. So, as we were saying, fichet, fantastic keys. We then have the monopole. When I showed this key to a friend of mine, Kunle, at Sprout, the better part of a year ago, I took the key out and I was photographing it and pulling it apart and taking some pictures for a friend of mine. This key, the key is probably about that long. And he, upon seeing it, said, oh, this is the sort of key that the knights died to protect. And the fichet company just makes beautiful, incredible, intricate mechanical locks. The function of this is that it pushes down through the lock, moving a series of levers out like the petals of a flower, and then the whole system can rotate freely. Again, we're not going to dive too deep into the mechanics of the fichet products. I just want you to see their keys. This is a fichet push lock. This key pushes into the lock, and the small differences between the cuts along the edge of both sides of the lock move a series of gears inside. And again, just beautiful. And this, then, is the fichet 3D. There's an interesting law passed in France just before the 3D came to market, where the French Patent Office basically declared that they would no longer be granting patents on keys unless the keys had a movable element inside of them. And that ruling, there was already some development in that realm. People had thought of movable elements for keys in the past, but it spurred the development of several manufacturers who wanted to continue operating in France and protecting their keys. Multilock Interactive, several other companies. Fichet, however, in their long history of gorgeous keys and crazy mechanical locks, couldn't be bothered. So, instead of adding a movable element to their key, they made a lock that could not be coded. Every internal piece of the lock is exactly the same. Every tumbler is precisely the same as the one past it. And the way that it is coded is that you put a key into it and then assemble everything around that key. And then when you remove the key, the lock is set to that key permanently. And what they did was they patent protected their keys as part of the assembly process for the locks. Getting around. They're a phenomenal company. Unfortunately, their locks are exceedingly expensive. I believe the 3D goes for 600 to 800 euro per lock. In fact, I was talking to a friend of mine who does a lot of work in France. He says, you know, the thing about the Fichet company is that their locks may or may not be particularly secure. The problem is that most private researchers never find out because they're so ungodly expensive. And many of the tests that we need to do to attack the security of these locks are destructive, so nobody wants to go through thousands of euros attacking these locks in various ways. So it's not security by obscurity, which is a term that we throw around a lot, but it's certainly security by financial aggression. Okay, now, the Norman lock. We will get into the details of how this lock works. This is an American lock, I believe patented in 1975, by Norman Epstein, or Norman Einstein, one or the other. Interesting dude, though. An interesting patent history. So, the way that this lock works is that there are a series of pins that have a small spool at the top of them, and rotating in that spool is a ball bearing. The way that these are lodged into their housing means that the ball bearing can only rotate around the just around this interior portion of the lock, but it has enough freedom to move that at rest all of the pins in the lock will be able to sort of collapse on one another a little bit. This piece here, piece 44, has a small leaf spring, 48, that constantly pushes back against the ball bearings. And again, there's enough room for the ball bearings to move that they're able to collapse on top of one another when the pins are at rest. With a key inserted, however, all of the ball bearings line up, forcing themselves into a line and pushing piece 44 into the cam. Now look again. With this out, the lock can spin freely without actually affecting the latch on the door. When this is pushed in, when it spins now, it turns the cam, which pulls the bolt, throws the latch, whatever the case may be. Simply by separating those two mechanisms, that's how this lock functions. There is, unfortunately, a significant problem with this particular design, but first, a couple of the benefits. Number one, you can't really apply tension to this, and when picking normally, we need to apply tension in order to manipulate the pins. Number two, even if you could apply tension, even if you could somehow make these pins bind for you, as you attempt to lift them to the right height, there is no feeling until the last ball bearing is in place. So you would just be lifting something arbitrarily, and you could never feel where the right position of the ball bearing was. You wouldn't know what the proper height was until you're shoving the last ball bearing into place, at which point you could start to feel them collide with one another. So picking, actual just normal picking, it would probably be nearly pick-proof, if not completely. I hate to say completely. Unfortunately, you can very easily just shove this into the can and turn the lock. This was, I don't know that it was ever mass-produced. I know that there are enough cylinders out there that, this is another one of my top three. And the Fache 3Ds as well, which is, normally modern locks don't make it that high up my list, but being that it's 800 euro, I'm not going to go out and purchase one anytime soon, so it'll probably be an old lock by the time I get one. But the Norman is absolutely one of my top three. And I know that there are enough out there that my friend Han Fei, who's one of the preeminent lock collectors in the world, when I said, oh, Han, have you ever seen a Norman lock? Have you ever actually been able to, like, look at one? He's like, yes, I have three. You can come look at them anytime you want. He did not offer to sell me one. So, we're going to talk history a little bit. And in particular, this stuff, all of this, is from patent diving. And my initial interest in history came from patent diving, and then you'll see on the next slide what really triggered my more obsessive interest. But I suggest, very much recommend, that everybody patent dive. Just go into Google Patents and start looking around. And when you hit on something that looks kind of interesting, look at the patents it references. Lose several hours of your day doing that. It's the most remarkable fun I've ever had, and particularly if you're doing it in your particular field of interest. But I've gone from locks off into other things just by following the trail of patent references. It's kind of remarkable, especially when a patent from, like the Norman lock references patents, again, this was patented, I think, 1975, and it's referencing patents from the late 1800s. It can get you back into some real, really interesting, and particularly for the mechanical trades, beautiful mechanical designs. So, as I began collecting locks, and as I was patent diving, I, of course, had heard of the Yale Lock Company, but then I got a lock in my collection that read, Yale and Town Manufacturing Company. My last name being Town, I called my father and said, hey, do you think that Henry Robinson Town could have been one of ours? We looked at a couple of things. He was, I think, out of Pennsylvania. I don't quite remember where he was born. I know he did a lot of his work in Pennsylvania. And my father got back to me and said, yes, he's one of ours. So about a year after learning to pick and really getting involved in locks, found out that we actually had some family relation involved. Pardon me. This, then, would be Yale. So Linus Yale Jr. is a really interesting figure. And we're going to talk a bit about pardon me. We're going to talk a bit about some of his designs, some of his work, One thing that I would like to say, there are two big things outside of the world of locks, informed by my love and obsession with locks, that I'd like to get my hands on. One is a painting bequeathed to the town family called The Landing of the Norsemen by the same person who painted Washington Crossing the Delaware. It was given to the Philadelphia Institute of Art by Henry Robinson Towne's father, Henry John Towne, or John Henry Towne, one or the other, who then sold it at auction for $90 about a decade later. When Henry Robinson Towne found out about this, he published a pamphlet called The Fate of a Fine Picture, which was just to discredit the Institute. Because it turned out that they had no legal means to make them purchase it back. Phenomenal painting, and was sold into a private collection in like the 1960s or something. So presently I'm desperately trying to hunt that down. So if any of you are art historians, hit me up. Because I would love to get my eyes on that. And eventually, someday, if locks make me a millionaire, purchase it. Similarly, Linus Yale Jr. was quite the portrait artist, and landscapes as well. He actually attempted not to go into mechanical engineering whatsoever and just go be an artist in the world, in Europe, and trained and left home and didn't follow his father's ambition, because Linus Yale Sr. was actually the initial inventor of the modern pentumbler lock, and Linus Yale Jr. would come along years later after his tour of trying to become an artist, go back to his father's concept and modernize and create what we're now used today. So, apparently, in his notebooks, when he got into mechanical design, he would draw intricate diagrams of locks, and also, right beside them, portraits of his friends that were in the room. And my God, I would love to get my eyes on those books. So, this is all just to illustrate my obsession with this history, these people, this art, and the crossover of art and design. This then is A.C. Hobbs, who's going to fill a lot of the rest of what we're going to talk about. I'll bring the lights up here in a second, because most of the rest of this is just me blathering, not as many pictures. But A.C. Hobbs has an interesting career. He toured around America, getting involved with the Day and Newell Company, and helped them design their paratoptic lock, which was a fairly intricate lever lock. He made a name for himself in the company by going to various bank directors and saying, "Hey, listen, if I can pick you the lock on your vault, you have to buy mine." And they would say, "Sure, go for it." And he would pick it, and they would buy it. And he made a huge name for himself doing this in every major city of the middle 1800s. And in particular, his big, and this was even mentioned in this obituary, his biggest moment, lock-wise, was the New York Mercantile Exchange held a competition saying, any man that can open our vault in 30 days, you have 30 days to study and work with it, any man that can open it will get, I think it was like $500. A.C. Hobbs came in and opened it in an hour. Devastatingly talented locksmith. So, these are the people we need to know. Really, really need to know Henry Robinson Towne, because he's my cousin. And a handsome man in a fine hat. Yale, we're going to talk a little more about, and A.C. Hobbs is going to be the featured player. But all of this takes place at the Great Exhibition. So let's get a little context. The Great Exhibition was held at the Crystal Palace in England in 1851. And this was basically what we now call a World's Fair, where countries from all over the world come and exhibit various, their best products of various industry. The Americans, when we showed up, we're looking like idiots. We looked like rubes. We looked like we had no idea what we were doing. Oh, and I turned the mouse off. Which various newspapers were very quick to point out. From the London Times, Our transatlantic descendants, following out their New World instincts, have no idea of being jostled by other nations or pinched for space, even in the Crystal Palace. While the industries of other countries have been screwing themselves up tight and getting into the smallest possible compass, that of the United States invites immigration from France, from ourselves, from the rest of Europe generally. Specifically, we had a ton of room, more so than almost any other country out there. We took up a ton of floor space and had almost nothing in that floor space. The number of exhibits that we actually had compared to the amount of floor space was ludicrous. So people were saying that this was like the prairie, the American, you know, west of the exhibition space. other nations, they also didn't like much of what we were exhibiting. Other nations rely upon their proficiency in the arts, or in manufacturers, or in machinery for producing effect. Not so with America. She is proud of her agricultural implements, which Garrett, Ransom, and May would reject as worthless. She is proud of her machinery, which would hardly fill one corner of our exhibition, and upon the merits of which our civil engineers would not pronounce a very flattering opinion. And she thinks a great deal of her first efforts in native marble by an untaught sculptor. That sculpture, by the way, was of a wounded Indian, and would later get a great deal of praise from other European sculptors. We also referred to the things that we were exhibiting as notions, which was roundly mocked in every newspaper that I've had hands on. What idea of Jonathan, which is what we used to be called back in the day, is to be gathered from his notions, and can we detect in the offspring the lineaments of its parents' face? England is not given to boasting and swaggering. She generally understates her strength and studies moderation of language about herself, though she has some excuse for being proud. An American newspaper later on would go on to say, man, won't it be great when we are humble enough to brag about being humble? but in very beautiful Victorian language, not my jackassery. Her Republican progeny are not so modest, if one may judge from the wings of that very aggressive American eagle with which the eastern end of the nave is decorated. The king of birds is hovering over a set of notions spread out very sparsely underneath him, and the visitor is somewhat astonished to find him making so vast a demonstration over a space so unoccupied. Specifically, we had this enormous gold-plated eagle freaking out over our exhibition, staring down the rest of the nations of the world, and once again, almost nothing underneath it. There are all sorts of phenomenal language in all of this, but in particular, where are the double pianos? Here we go. They talk about many of the things that we are actually exhibiting, even in their ingenuity, great as it is, becomes ridiculous when it attempts competition with Europe. Double pianos, a combination of a piano and a violin, a chair with a cigar case in its back, and other mongrel constructions belong to a people that would be centaurs and mermen if they could, and are always rebelling against the trammels of unity. Now, every audience that I have spoken to, upon hearing that we were accused of wanting to be centaurs and mermen, still want to be. If given the opportunity, I would be a centaur in a heartbeat. And this goes on. Even the Illustrated News got involved. The London Times, in particular, just reveled in ripping into us in article after article after article in the opening weeks of the exhibition. But again, even the Illustrated News finished up an article saying simply, can they wonder that we laugh a little, or can they doubt that this laughing will do them? Vicious. So we were seen as jokes, constantly being talked about as, you know, our progeny, our children, you know. This, you know, we were not too long yet divorced from the mother country at this point in time. So, things weren't looking good for old America at the exhibition. The reason that everything was very sparse in our area, one of the reason that there was no unity of theme amongst all of our exhibits, is that the American government was not at all involved in setting up this exhibition space for us. The American wing of things, every exhibitor present was the actual inventor of the exhibit. They were the company or the individual who had created the thing that was being shown. They got themselves over there with their own money. And as such, there was no unifying force where many, if not all, of the other nations had direct, you know, federal involvement in making this a beautiful showcase of their country. It's a phenomenal several paragraphs that get, you know, I'm sure seemed entirely innocent in 1851, but would be incredibly political now, that simply talk about the complete divorce of government from manufacturing and how it has done so well for America. So, the first big test that was had where America could come out and kind of show off some of the things that she had created was in agriculture. Specifically, we had this sweet plow and this sweet reaping machine. So the plow, it suddenly occurred to me that this often becomes a very profane talk, just in that I get very excited. So my apologies if I drop some F-bombs later. Not my intention, but I get big into this reaping machine in particular. I don't even know how reaping machines work. But I'm so proud. So the plow, first of all, was this small, tiny compared to some of the European plows with what looked like very thin blades that, as people were coming by the exhibition looking at this prior to the test and even on the grounds before the test was to take place, were saying things to the effect of, you know, nice plow, idiot. Even if that can manage to cut into the ground, as soon as it hits a rock, it's going to snap. There's no way that's going to be able to do what you need it to do. So the Americans come out to the test. Many of these tests and exhibitions of the actual products were just done at like the private estates of people with a bunch of jurors for the exhibition. So the plow was done on some farmer's estate. And there was some more joking about the American plow, but then when it went out to actually cut into the ground, the farmer said, you know, hey, why don't you stand on my plow, get this horse out, and we'll go plow away. And it plowed the crap out of that ground. It tore it up. Literally. Pardon me. The only knock against it by the jurors was that it plowed too rough a furrow. It wasn't quite clean enough for the jurors. To which the British farmer said, no, that's exactly how we like it. If the furrow is too clean, we have to go through and re-break parts of the ground as we do our planting later. And so it sold like crazy. It was sold immediately to many farmers. Then the reaping machine. So the reaping machine was pretty crazy. Specifically because they had the test on like the worst possible day for reaping, apparently. Again, I'm working off source records. I don't know what's happening in this photo. Clearly not a photo. So I don't know how reaping works, but the corn was wet. It was pouring rain. The corn was still green, which is apparently terrible for reaping. And everyone said, you know what? Why don't we do this another day? But each of the people, a couple of Brits, there were two Americans, and I can't remember what other countries represented, said, you know what? No, we're going to try it anyway. We'll give it a shot. So the first American goes out, and his reaping machine totally just breaks and is no longer functional whatsoever. So they bring him back, and he says, nah, I'm going to go and get it now. Everybody, most of the people running machines included, were like, yeah, all right, we'll do it another day. This is a terrible day. We knew it was, but we'll reconvene. But the other American says, no, hell no, absolutely not. I am here to reap. So he gets out on his reaping machine and reaps the hell out of the field. Corn's going everywhere, or like into the spot it's supposed to go. I know, but it's being reaped like crazy, like mad. Nobody can believe it. And the tone of the newspapers now changes just a little bit. And I swear this all relates to locks in the end. But the tone of the papers now says, wow. Look at that. Look at these bumbling Americans. Turns out, they actually know a thing or two about agriculture. And you know what? They're farming a lot of land out there. Sure. We'll give them that. Great. Thanks, guys. Thanks for showing up. Good stuff. But then, the yachts. The yachts were devastated. there were, I don't know, something ridiculous, like 30 or 40 British yachts that were competing in what had, you know, they opened up this sort of annual yacht race to the entire international community to participate in. The American yacht was the only international boat to compete. All of the other ones were still British yachts. So there were, I don't know, again, maybe 40 British yachts, and then the American yacht, which was called the America. So, this was a very quick yacht, and people in the British yachting community had been paying attention as this yacht was even being built. People were interested in seeing, you know, if it could actually hold up, because there were some new ideas being incorporated into it. And when it came out, the owner of the ship, upon initially mooring wherever it was they moored, I can't remember now, went around trying to, like, get some races together, get some people to come out racing. So he had one race where he beat the guy that he was racing against, and after that guy got beat, nobody really wanted to get involved until this big international event. It was 53 miles around a couple of islands, and the Queen came out. Everybody's very excited. The Queen came out to watch the race. And the way that this was structured was that, you know, they would do a loop out and then come back around. And as they would go along, they're passing by a couple islands where there are parties going on for this race and people, like, celebrating and watching the boats as they come around. There would be groups of smaller vessels that would sail out along the race path to, you know, see the ships as they approached and as they went by again. And so, there's this interesting, you know, fervor and reporting as the boats went around. And as the first, you know, first group set off, the America actually came out really slow. There's a fouled anchor and things weren't looking good right off the bat. So we were right in the back of the pack when we got started. But even by the time we came up upon the first island, we were in fifth. We had made up a ton of ground. So we stayed in there, in that front pack of five, and then in the front pack of threes, as we're coming around another group of islands, and people are saying, oh, look at that, the America holding her own, right up there in the top. We heard that she might be fast. That's great. Good for her, coming around another island, still in that, you know, 1, 2, 3 grouping. Ah, the America, really, really doing good, really, really doing okay in there. And then we won by 7 miles. By 7 miles in a 53-mile race. That's obscene. That's nuts. That's incredible. And to sort of put a fine point on how ridiculously far ahead we were, as our yacht began to pass the Queen's barge before the race was finished, the race was still going on, they slowed down, lowered their colors, and then every member of the crew stood out on the deck and lowered their hats and bowed their heads to the Queen as they went past. The British newspapers described this as a jockey stopping his horse before the race was finished to wave at the crowd. It was the most ludicrous thing to do, but we were, again, winning by 7 miles, so we had plenty of time to say hey to the Queen. And the Brits freaked out about this. The Brits were going crazy. They were screaming, applauding. There was apparently a man with his own private militia that just started firing off their guns in a salute. And guns, that's another thing, by the way, that the British bought all of our guns for their armies. The technology that we brought to bear was just ridiculous. So after the yacht and at that moment, people were yelling, who was first? And they'd yell, America! Well, who was second? No one! Which is probably where we got that attitude from. So the yachts were ridiculous. There were other people, too. Goodyear was there, showing off his innovative India rubber globes. And, yeah, we'll see what those might turn into someday. All sorts of people. Again, the guns, etc. So after the yacht race, and this was, Wikipedia will tell you it was August 22nd. However, the source records that I've dug into claim that it was August 18th. I don't know. I haven't looked at the Wikipedia sources, but mine say the 18th. And during that time, while that was going on, Hobbs again was in the middle of a 30-day trial against Joseph Brahma's lock, the Brahma safety lock. Brahma himself died in 1814, but his sons continued the company after his death. They were a phenomenal company, and what Joseph Brahma did for physical security is absolutely remarkable. He democratized it. It was 1784 when he got the patent on the Brahma safety lock, and it went into mass production soon thereafter. And for the first time, almost anyone could have a lock. Locksmiths used to make locks. Every lock used to be its own unique creation. This is where the concept of security by obscurity originated in physical security, in that if you understood the function of the lock on someone's door, you could open it consistently. You just had to understand how it worked. That's all it was. So that secret of its function was kept vitally by the locksmith and by yourself. And those were the only people who knew how it would work. Joseph Brahma applied mass production techniques to producing locks. So before Brahma came along, a lock would cost you the modern equivalent of about 4,000 pounds. Brahma's most expensive lock, I believe his most expensive lock, was less than 1,000 pounds in the modern equivalent, and his cheapest lock was about 25 pounds. Remarkable. So, after the yachts, the papers changed again, and it was more celebratory in the Americans now. They were saying, you know, hey, the Americans, they know a couple of things, and other people started to be brought up as well, like their guns and like Goodyear, and they started singling out all of these interesting exhibitors. And people were starting to say, you know what, America is bringing as much to bear here for us as any other country at the moment. So what Hobbs ended up doing was kind of putting the last nail in the coffin of the British sense of self-worth. He went over to, he was there representing Newell and Day with their paratoptic clock. And many of the exhibitors there who were exhibiting safes and other security devices would have a paratoptic lock on their device. His lock, the Newell and Day lock, which would go on to be called the Hobbs lock, because he never went home again and just stayed in England for 16 years making his million selling this lock, was protecting most things in the American department. So he went over to Brahma, and the Brahma company had had in their window in Piccadilly for decades a small lock with a plaque on it that read, "To the maker of the instrument that can open this lock, 200 guinea." In the 1820s, a British engineer took a very serious effort against it over many days, but failed to open it. I want to get my dates right. Yes, on July 23rd, again, before the yachting, and this would finish on August 23rd, after the yachting. Can't see anything. He would actually get it open. So he had about 30 days to work on it. Started on July 23rd, ended on August 23rd. They had the exhibit ready. They had it ready for him on the 23rd. He began on the 24th, opened it on August 23rd. Now, people will say, and I heard this a lot when I was first beginning to pick locks, oh man, he had 30 days to work on that thing. Well, in reality, he actually only had 16 days of access to the lock. Throughout the course of those 16 days, during that 30-day period, he had 51 hours of access to that lock. So, don't get me wrong, 51 hours is still a ludicrous amount of time, but when the Mercantile Exchange are advertising, you know, 30 days against our vault and you get, you know, a ton of money, it was the way of things at that point in time. Presently, in the modern age, we have a sense of time resistance against locks, not the sense of pure impenetrability that they had at that point in time. They just genuinely thought that their locks were perfectly impenetrable. So, Hobbs manages to open it. On the, I believe, the 28th or the 29th, the entire collection of jurors reconvenes, and he opens and closes it for them at will. Once he had built the tools to attack this lock, he could attack it very consistently. Another important note about the Brahma demonstration. The Brahma company, Brahma's sons, were phenomenally upfront about this whole contest. They once the jurors, you know, gave their decision, they paid him the money, they, you know, went on record as their locks having been beaten, and, you know, went on to make, you know, better and more intricate locks from there on out. Additionally, the lock was provided to Hobbs in the best possible situation. You know, it was a padlock, but it was mounted into a wood block, so it was wholly immovable. He had his entire kit of tools. He had tons of time alone with it to attack it. It was, you know, the best situation for the lock picker, the worst situation for the lock company. Conversely, the Chubb Company, the other company that was considered to have an impenetrable lock in England, never agreed to a formal test against Hobbs, but because people were very curious, you know, after his success against the Brahma lock, somebody at the exhibition was securing something with a Chubb lock and said, could you pick this? And he worked on it for a little while and got it open. And they're like, wow, all right, this might not be the best test. So a private gentleman with his own vault invited everybody out and another team of jurors. This was not a part of the official goings-on of the Great Exhibition, but it was a private man and a group of well-respected citizens who could pass a judgment on it, invited him out, and they were going to have a similar trial against the Chubb lock on his vault that Hobbs had had against the Brahma. So people were, you know, ready to lock in for a long struggle, and much like the mercantile exchange, he had it open within an hour. And the jurors were shocked. The jurors couldn't believe it, and the accounts of both attempts and both openings were recorded in many of the papers. And so this is a landmark moment. This entire exhibition was a landmark moment in how the U.S. was perceived, at least by the nations of Europe, if not by the rest of the world. And again, you can track the tone of it in the newspapers. An American paper published, and this has one of my favorite lines in the world. It gives me chills every time I read it. America still adds to her laurels in England. In addition to making the fastest yachts, the best plows, the most serviceable reaping machines, etc., etc., she can now boast about doing the world in picking locks. The distinction is of somewhat questionable character. Generally, the persons who have been most expert at this business have not enjoyed in the highest degree the respect and confidence of society at large. A man, out of employment, who should advertise himself capable of picking any lock in the world would not be regarded with favor by bank directors. President Fillmore would, probably, not appoint a sub-treasurer for the city of New York any man whose sole recommendation should be that no lock ever made could withstand his ingenuity. Nationally, however, the prejudice does not seem to obtain. England seems to think just as much of us, and even a little more, although we have beaten her in everything and picked her locks besides. I mean, granted I am a lock picker, but I can think of no better national rallying cry than that. et cetera, et cetera. But they speak very respectfully of us, and even the Times of London, again, who had been our biggest attractors, and even the Times inclined to give the Yankee his due, how thoroughly we have played hob with their locks. Which is a phrase we need to get back into. And the London Times did, in fact, give us our due. I am going to read much of this. We believed before the exhibition opened that we had the best locks in the world. And among us, Brahma and Chubb were reckoned quite as impregnable as Gibraltar. More so indeed, for the key of the Mediterranean was taken by us, but none among us could penetrate into the locks and shoot the bolts of these makers. In this faith, we had quietly established ourselves for years, and it seems cruel at this time of day, when men have been taught to look at their bunches of keys and at their drawers and safes with something like confidence, to scatter that feeling to the winds. as I said, the sense of British self-worth. Gone. I feel bad beating up on the Brits this much, but they beat up on us so bad, it's hard not to. The mechanical spirit, however, is never at rest, and if it is lulled into a false state of listlessness in one branch of industry and in one part of the world, elsewhere it springs up suddenly to admonish and reproach us with our supineness. And what amazing language. That's the best thing about doing this research in Victorian times. It's just gorgeous. Our descendants on the other side of the water are, every now and then, administering to the mother country a wholesome filial lesson upon this very text. And recently they have been rubbing us up with a severity which perhaps we merited for sneering at their shortcomings in the exhibition. While we've been relying on while we've been relying implicitly upon the artful arrangement of tumblers and such like devices, they have been carefully developing their ingenuity in picking and opening locks. A man makes a lock, and he brings it to a mechanics institute in New York with a certain sum of money secured by it, which sum becomes the property of the successful operator who can shoot back the bolt of the new contrivance. This actually went on. That's not flowery language. People would bring locks that they had designed to mechanics institutes, engineering meetings, etc. And they would put up a sum of money that you would get if you opened it. Additionally, the person attacking it would typically have to put up a sum of money in case they broke the lock. Should that happen, they got to keep the prototype, but the money would go to the inventor so he could build a new one. Amazing. And how have we lost that? Well, there are actually a whole number of reasons, but that's a whole other time. It was an amazing time. Instantly, astute heads and clever expert hands are engaged in solving the mechanical riddle thus propounded to them. And so far have these dexterous manipulators carried their art that their open sesame sweeps springs, tumblers, false notches, letter devices, and everything else before it. Mr. Hobbs is by far the most accomplished and successful of these performers, and he has come over to this country at a very opportune moment to teach our makers a very useful lesson. Chubb refused to ever admit that Hobbs had picked his locks, because Chubb had never agreed to a formal trial. After the reports came out in the papers, Chubb was clamoring for a formal trial, trying to get Hobbs in to do a formal trial against his locks. For Hobbs, who had decided to stay in the country at that point and just sell the lock, it was much better business for Chubb to be freaking out, literally taking out advertisements in Mechanics magazine saying, "I know you've all heard that our locks have been picked by this guy, but I swear they haven't," than to ever actually attack the lock again. So he never readdressed the lock. But everybody, including the newspapers, knew. It is well known, however Mr. Chubb may wrestle with the statement, that Mr. Hobbs has succeeded by perfectly fair means in opening his locks as they have hitherto been made. No formal or deliberate trial has taken place between them to establish the fact, but it nevertheless remains undoubted. And the sooner Mr. Chubb improves his patent so as to set Mr. Hobbs at deviance, the better for his own interests. They go on to talk about how well Rama have handled it, which I already told you, and they also encourage the British lockmakers to go attack the American locks. And they say, if you can't open them, go back to work and start making some better locks. So they did. The British lockmakers came over and attacked the paratoptic lock. And the people who took trial against it completely failed and had to return it wholly unmolested, entirely unopened. In the months before Hobbs came with the Day of Newell lock to the Great Exhibition, Day of Newell received a letter from an American engineer by the name of Pettis saying, "Hey, I know you've made a bunch of new advances in your lock. However, I can still open it. Let me tell you how." And he described from how he was attacking it, and the Newell and Day Company were then able to advance their lock, to improve upon their design to prevent the attacks of Pettis. Had they not done that, I am relatively confident they would not have fared so well in England, but it would not have been quite so resolute a victory. A decade later, Linus Yale Jr. is playing around in his workshop with a paratoptic lock and opens it. And is very excited for a moment, and then looks around and realizes that in opening the paratoptic lock, he's discovered a means that he can open every lock that he's ever made, and thus decides that any lock with a key can be picked, which is something that I had heard from so many locksport people, not knowing the history of this. And he was saying this in the 1860s. So he then went on to develop the Monitor Safe Lock, which is the progenitor of all dial combination locks that we have today. He briefly, you know, developed further the pin tumbler lock and is rightly credited with that. But again, he had the belief that a lock with a key can always be picked. And my God, he's right about pin tumbler locks in particular. And so mostly abandoned it in his own work. Henry Towne, however, realized quite rightly that the format of the lock, the means of mass producing it, meant that it could be quite the hit. And thus, marketing-wise and further development-wise, made it the primary locking cylinder in America. And worth noting, and I'm not going to go any further than this, I know we're already a little under time, the technology in your locks, as of 3 years ago, your normal residential lock, the two major brands of residential lock in America, have remained wholly unchanged since 1868. And I don't mean that they were still basically the same idea, I mean that there had been literally no change whatsoever for 150 years. Until about 3 years ago with the Kwikset Smart Key. But that's, again, a whole other talk. So, thank you.
So it is just 6 o'clock. I'm sure Skylar would be happy to answer questions, but Skylar needs to leave now. Okay.
Excellent. Yeah, does anybody have any questions? Yeah.
Are there any sort of written books or compilations about lock history, or have you done any writing yourself?
So there are a couple of great ones. Pardon me again. Yes, there are some great ones. Specifically, you know what? I will write these down. So, The Lure of the Lock. The Lure of the Lock is difficult to get your hands on, no longer in print, but it details the Mossman collection. Which resides in New York at a building that I can't remember the name of. You have to get an appointment to go in and actually see it. It's, I think, one of the old mechanics institutes in New York. But the Mossman collection is this remarkable collection of locks. Lure of the Lock, I think, was written in the 1920s, 1930s, but a remarkable history of that collection in particular, and talking about many pieces involved. Additionally, American Genius is a book that was only released, within the last decade, I think, but remarkable volume on time locks in particular, safe locks, vaults, and time locks, with some of the most gorgeous photographs of all of these old devices. That's definitely worth picking up. I mean, you can find that on Amazon, like, today. additionally, there's a book published for the Bicentennial as part of the Bicentennial book series called... I think that it was maybe something like that. But if you Google Bicentennial, I'm not going to try to spell Bicentennial. Never mind. if you Google Bicentennial book locks, lock makers, I know lock makers in there.
Locks and lock makers of America.
Locks and locks makers of America.
Yeah.
Excellent. It's a very slim volume, but phenomenal, and one of its best features is that it literally just has lists and lists of patents. So many, with often very little explanation behind them, but it got to the point where, starting from that book, this was another thing that launched me into my historical research, an uncle of mine has made his living for years now just buying up huge lots of books and then selling the rare ones. So when he found out that I was in the locks, he gave me the Bicentennial one, which isn't terribly rare at all. And just diving through those patents listed in there, because so many of them, the Google OCR is only so good, so occasionally you're going to get mislistings and things. So, I'd hit on a patent that, Google thought was like, new look, pack proof. which was really, you know, new pick-proof lock. That nobody in the locksport community, to my knowledge, had found yet, and would share that with my friends and dove in from there. So those three books in particular, I would definitely recommend getting. The work that I'm doing now will, I'm sure, at some point when I've solved a lot of other problems, turn into at least a significant paper, if not a book. Anybody else?
I had a question about the lock with the lock spring in it that you showed us. Was it actually physically unprotected, the swinging from the keyway?
So that idea, that concept, becomes a problem in many, many, many locks, not just that.
Mm-hmm.
So, the concept of detaching the cam from the rest of the cylinder is incredibly popular in electronic locks. So, if you ever approach an electronic lock, or a push-button lock, where you can turn the handle but nothing happens until you push the code in,
yeah,
all that's happened is the handle mechanism has been detached from the cam. Very frequently, the piece that will bridge that gap and will connect the two is ferrous. So with a significantly strong magnet placed in the appropriate point on the lock, you can simply connect the cam,
sure,
and open that lock without ever dialing anything, etc. Specifically, if you want to see modern examples of this, there's currently a lawsuit out against the Kaba Corporation, who make these simplex locks. Those are the black push-button locks, typically have a rack of five. The other problem with those is that you can brute force them in about 10 minutes. You can go through every possible combination of them because their key space is shockingly limited. So there's a lawsuit now against the Kaba Simplex, if you can track that down. The best information I have about that is currently private, so I can't share it publicly, but if you can, but I'm sure there's some public records of it starting to take place. So
Kaba keyless locks, openwiththenagle.com.
Are you serious?
That's a class action lawsuit.
Wait, say it again.
Kaba keyless locks, openwiththenagle.com. I should just Google Kaba Simplex and Magnet.
That is amazing.
I'm just going to make a domain.
That is fantastic. And additionally, the Winkhouse Blue Chip. This was a very expensive, very high security RFID-based lock that actually had a very robust authentication mechanism. Once again, they separated cam from handle, and thus, with a significantly strong magnet, you could just walk through any of those doors. So, that concept taking place in the Norman lock is something that comes up. This is something that we see in physical security all the time, which, when kibitzing with my information security friend, seems to carry over. We are constantly seeing, and there are a couple of people out there who basically have made their living for the past, 20, 30 years, just taking, a list of like 10 attacks, seeing what locks came out this year, and seeing if each of those attacks, just rolling those attacks over, seeing what locks will fall to it. Cam separation is a big one that we see all the time, that keeps coming up year after year, brand new lock after brand new lock. So this repetition of ancient attacks is constant.
Yeah.
Anyone else? Excellent. Thank you all very much. Appreciate it.
Thank you.